Toronto. VK on the beat, check. I'm in Toronto, where you wanna get the city love. I'm from Toronto, where you wanna get the city love. I'm in Toronto, like you wanna get the city love. My city love me back. Welcome to episode 1012 of Toronto Mic'd, proudly brought to you by Great Lakes Brewery, a fiercely independent craft brewery who believes in supporting communities, good times, and brewing amazing beer. Order online for free local home delivery in the GTA. StickerU.com. Create custom stickers, labels, tattoos, and decals for your home and your business. Palma Pasta. Enjoy the taste of fresh homemade Italian pasta and entrees from Palma Pasta in Mississauga and Oakville. Ridley Funeral Home. Pillars of the community since 1921. Canna Cabana. The lowest prices on cannabis. Guaranteed. Over 100 stores across the country. Learn more at cannacabana.com. And Ryobi. Join the cordless revolution with Ryobi's 18-volt One Plus system. There are 260 tools in the system, and it's available now at Home Depot. Joining me this week is founder and lead singer of Men Without Hats, Ivan Doroschuk. Welcome, Ivan.
Hi, how are you?
What a pleasure to meet you. We have a mutual friend. I want to shout out Pete Fowler off the top. Pete said, Mike, you've got to get Ivan on the show. And I'm like, well, duh, of course I do. And I'm so glad you're here.
Cool. Thanks for having me.
Right on, the serious tip off the top, an interesting question came in from Diamond Dog, a listener of this program. Diamond Dog would like me to ask you, and I'm curious myself, do you still have family in Ukraine, and how are they doing?
We don't. We're a few generations removed.
Okay. Well, I'm glad everybody's safe in your world, and it's awful what is happening in your home of your ancestors.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go back. Before we come back to the present day, let's go back. Would you mind sharing with us basically how did Men Without Hats come to be? Let's go way back here.
Well, it was 1976, and I was studying law in the south of France. And I would go and shop for records, you know, whenever I could. And then one day I came across this record by the Sex Pistols. And I said, no, that's, they shouldn't be doing that. That's wrong. That's wrong. But the name's, you know, it's kind of stuck in my head. And after my lost this, you know, I did my first year of law, I came back and I came back to Canada, and I kind of rode in on the same wave that punk new wave was coming in on too, you know, so we kind of landed back in North America at the same time. Anyways, I enrolled in McGill University in the film and communications program. And that was kind of the year punk broke, and it was 77. And I met a bunch of guys film and communications department. That's where I met the three guys who I formed, the three original members, John Gurin, Dave Hill, and Pete Seabrook. We're all just sitting beside me in the classroom. And we just started talking and decided to form a band and decided to pick the name of the band before we'd even practiced or anything like that. So,
well, I was going to ask you, where exactly does this name Men Without Hats come from?
Oh, I'm the one who chose that. it just came literally off the top of my head. It was the story goes that my brothers and I were too rugged to wear toques in the cold Montreal winters, and that's where the name comes from.
You were real men without hats in the cold.
Yeah, real men don't wear hats.
Kind of. The cold tundra of Montreal. I mean, you know, our climate's pretty similar here. And I won't go biking in the winter without a balaclava on, okay? So I am not a man without hat.
Yeah, well, you know, you can bend the rules. It's not a problem.
All right, my friend, great question came in, and in a moment I'm going to play a song, and then we're going to talk about that, because you can imagine the questions I got about a certain song. And you've got a number of great songs in the catalog, and we're going to eventually hear some new stuff, which sounds fantastic, by the way. But this question came from Adrian. He says, please ask him what it was like opening for the Stranglers in 1980 at the concert hall.
I remember that one. I remember that one very well, because back in the days, one of the things that punk crowds did to the bands that they didn't like was they spat on them. Mm. And so I got rained on for a couple opening sets there by Strangler fans. And yeah, it wasn't too pleasant. I mean, the Stranglers were great. I love the Stranglers. I was a huge Strangler. Still am a huge Strangler fan.
Right. Well, that was the day you wish you were a man with a hat, I suppose.
I wish I were a man with an umbrella. Mm-hmm.
That's the spin-off.
And they were throwing all kinds of stuff too. They were throwing lighters and quarters and stuff. So it was.
Well, that's punk, right? You gotta.
It was definitely punk. Definitely punk.
All right, I'm debating with myself. I think I'm going to play, if you don't mind hearing yourself, and I hope you don't mind, I'm going to play a little bit of a song called The Safety Dance, and then we're going to get into it, because I have some questions for you, so I hope this is okay with you. We're going to just listen to a bit, yeah. And then I'll fade it down here.
Yeah, sure.
Here we go.
We can dance if we want to, we can leave your friends behind. Cause your friends don't dance, and if they don't dance, well, they're no friends of mine. See, we can go where we want to, place where they will never find. And we can act like we come from out of this world, leave the real one far behind. We can dance. We can go if we want to, night is young and so am I. And we can dress real neat from our hearts to our feet and surprise them with a victory cry. Say, we can act if we want to, if we don't nobody will. And you can act real rude and totally removed, and I can act like an imbecile. Say, we can dance, everything's out of control. We can dance, we can dance, we're doing it from pole to pole. We can dance. We can dance, everybody look at your hands. We can dance, we can dance, everybody's taking the chance.
Ivan, I don't even really want to turn this down. I'm digging it, man. But what's it like for you to hear this song again in your headphones there? Like, does it take you right back?
Oh, yeah. Especially listening to my first ex-wife sing the background vocals there. Brings me back.
Is that a good memory or one that you're...
Oh, yeah. Very good memory. It's all good. It's all good. Don't worry.
Okay, good to hear that. So the first question on this note here comes from Tom Jokic. And Tom would like, he says basically, Ivan's story of how getting thrown out of an Ottawa nightclub inspired the safety dance is really great. Have fun with him. So can I hear that story?
Yeah, that's a true story. I used to hang out in Ottawa. I used to have friends who lived in Ottawa, and I used to go out there a lot, and we'd party in the discotheques. And it was the dying days of disco, and every now and then the disc jockey would slip in a Blondie Heart of Glass or, you know, B-52 Rock Lobster. And we'd get up and start pogoing. And pogoing was just jumping up and down and bouncing off each other. It was kind of the precursor to slam dancing and the mosh pit.
Sure, I remember the last pogo at the horseshoe.
Exactly.
Town. Yes.
Exactly. And so, but you know, in those days, you know, late 70s, the bouncers and the rest of the people dancing had never seen anything like it, and they just assumed that we were fighting or trying to cause a fight or you know, up to no good. Right. And I was getting tossed out regularly for doing that. So I went home and wrote this song as a tribute to that.
When you wrote The Safety Dance and when it came together, Like, did you have any idea, like, what you had done? You know, what a massive hit that would be, a worldwide hit, I'll point out. Like, did you have any sense of what you had created?
Well, I got to be truthful with you. And when you're a young songwriter, you think that everything that you write is going to be a worldwide smash hit, and you just can't understand how people are just not getting it, you know?
Right.
So what happened was that we released it, the single, and we didn't have an American deal or anything. Like, we had a Canadian deal. We were signed to a small British label, Static Record, a guy who used to work for Virgin Records, who went off and started his own label. And he signed us, and we were actually being sold as an import in Canada. So
that's strange.
The single came out. Yeah. The single came out, and it went up to, I think, number 12 in Canada or something like that. And we were stoked. We were like in top 40. Wow. You know, this is like, we're happening, you know, we made it. And, you know, the label had, you know, sold enough copies to put us into the studio for a second album. And we were super stoked. We were like, wow, like, you know, we're making another record. This is like unbelievable, you know? And then they said, while we were making the second record, they said, okay, guys, we got to do this thing called a 12-inch remix. Everybody's doing it. We want you guys to do one too. And you just got to take Safety Dance and stretch it out, put some, you know, things here and there, and just, you know, make it a dance, kind of more of a dance floor thing. But more, you know, mostly just drag it out. And right. So we did. And went, and then we, you know, sent it off to them and went back in the studio and kept working on our second record.
So I went and looked it up, because I'm like, I know it's a hit here, because I'm born and raised in Toronto, and I know it's a hit here, but I sometimes don't have a sense of, like, what's a hit in Canada, but the, you know, Americans are like, I don't know that song. Like, sometimes I'm surprised to find out, like, oh, Americans weren't, like, listening to Sloan the way I was listening to Sloan, you know what I mean? So
right.
I looked it up, and the Safety Dance spent 4 weeks at number 3 on the Billboard Hot 100. That is a massive hit. What a big deal that is. Do you have any memory of what kept you out at the top spot? Like, what do you have any memory of what was number one for those weeks?
Oh, I don't know. There was so many big bands in those days. I mean, every, you know, you'd look at the top 10, and, you know, those guys are still around, you know, they're huge people. So it was, I didn't really care. Like, it was right. Like, we were there. We'd already been number one on the dance charts. So we were just completely, you know, stoked, like I said, again. And no, it was great. It was
amazing.
a whole just a great adventure just starting up there.
Amazing. Now I got a question from a gentleman named Mark Weisblatt, who he's very interested on, he's interested in, like, how much money you can make off a big hit like that. And I mean, I'm not asking to see your, like, taxes here or anything like that, but can you give us a sense of how lucrative the Safety Dance has been for you since you released it in, whatever, 1982?
Well, I've never had to get a second job. Let's put it that way. Okay.
No, excellent. I mean, I can only imagine, but because you do hear, you know, I'm sure now with streaming and stuff, like, if you want to capture a mood, it's particularly a 1980s mood, the Safety Dance is a heck of a way to do it. Like, what a jam that is. So I'm sure there's, yeah, you know, there's endless possibilities there.
I'm blessed. I'm totally blessed. It's like, I'm a music fan myself. That's how one of the reasons I got into this business is because I was a major super fan myself. And that was one of the tools that I consider was one of the tools that got me in the door. And when I go back now and I look at all the bands that I grew up listening to or even missed, you know, like, that I discovered now, and I see how many bands put their hearts and their soul and their lives and their families and their savings and their house and their mortgage, everything into the music, and, you know, and most of them never got heard, you know, most of them never didn't get the chance, didn't get remembered, you know, for, it's like, you know, it's like the NHL, you know, for every guy who makes it, there's a couple thousand who don't, you know, so it's the same type of thing. So it's, I have to always keep that in mind and be very, very thankful for where I am and who I am, and thank my fans never forget the fans, because they're the ones who, you know, the couple of songs, I had a couple of songs put into the Canadian Songwriters Hall of Fame, and nobody did that, but I didn't do that. My fans did that.
Right.
You know, I didn't, you know, I wrote the song, everybody writes the songs, but the fans are the ones who determine which ones go into the Hall of Fame or not, you know? So I got nothing but thanks for all you people. Thank you.
And that's awesome. So I, you know, having somebody 40 years later, let's say some guy named Mike, like having him, you know, ask you about this, you know, this jam you released 40 years ago, that never gets tiresome for you?
Never. You know, I get asked that a lot too, you know, and it never, the song is a lot bigger than I am, you know, and sometimes I feel like I'm a museum curator going around with the traveling artifact, this artifact that I present to people all over the world, and it brings them this immense joy, you know, and that's so it's pretty much outside of me, you know. I'm kind of one of the people who's sitting around saying, wow, you know, that's, I remember that song.
You know,
go ahead.
I was going to say, we haven't yet invented time travel. So I think the closest thing we have is that somebody, you know, who remembers 1982, 83, somebody can hear that song that you wrote and be transported back. It's quite magical.
I don't know if you can hear me, but I lost you.
Oh, I can hear you. Yes. Can you hear me now? I can't lose Ivan from Men Without Hats. You there, buddy?
Yeah, I'm back.
Okay.
You froze there for a while.
Okay, I'm glad you're back here. Let me read a statement from Andrew Ward, who's a listener. He writes, Mike, one of the great new wave synth hits was The Safety Dance, but equally good is I've Got the Message. It was released in the UK during the summer of 1982 and got bounced around as a B-side until it was released in North America in early 1984. Can you ask Ivan how frustrating this was for Men Without Hats, considering how awesome the song is?
Well, I'm glad you asked that, because I could write a book about that song. That was the first song released off the album anywhere in Canada. I Got the Message. That was my choice. That was, for me, the obvious choice for a first single. For me, it was an obvious hit. It had all the parts. It had everything. You know, it had, for Canada, it had English and French. It had everything. It was, right. It was like multiple lyrics you could sing along with. Title of the song, you know, firmly in the song itself, in the lyrics. We released it in Canada first, and it also, I think, went into the top 40, and then that's released. Safety Dance was second. It was supposed to be the second single after the Safety Dance was released in the States. We were supposed to put out I Got the Message. And Tim Pope and I worked on a video for I Got the Message. It has a follow-up to Safety Dance, and it has a lot of the same characters in it. And the day before we got to shoot the video, the record company phoned us and said, we're not going to release I Got the Message. We're going to release I Like as a single. And we said, well, what are you going to do? What do we do about the video? They said, just shoot the video, you know, just change the music, whatever. Take the same. And so we said, okay, whatever, we'll do that, you know. But the reason they gave us for putting I Like out was because they didn't want the band to turn into they didn't want the band to be perceived as a hit factory or a hit machine, and they wanted to give the band a harder edge. And we were like, wow, you're actually telling us that you're putting out a single, that you're putting out this single so that you don't sell more records. Is that that's the logic behind this? And it kind of, yep. Well, we don't want you to be a one hit wonder. So we're going to put out a real, you know, sort of hard edge song, which, you know, it became a hit. It became, I mean, amongst our fans, but it definitely didn't go number three for 3-4 weeks on the Billboard charts. And the dance version definitely didn't go number one on the Billboard dance chart, you know, where I Got the Message, I'm sure it would have.
Well, Ivan, can I play a little I Got the Message just so the listeners can hear some of this?
Oh, yeah.
Now, let me hear a bit of this.
on all fours. We'll live long and hard on this road to Mars.
Why is it, I guess you'll tell me now, but why is it that the record label has so much control over aspects of the art like this? I mean, is it just that's their department?
That's basically, they take it upon themselves. They think that because they pay for it, they...
Yeah. You are frozen.
Okay, we resequenced the album. Okay, I'm back now.
Now you're back, yes.
I was telling a story of what happened at our label once that, the new Simple Minds record came out, and the guy at the Canadian record label resequenced the album because he thought the Canadian audience needed a different sequence. And so, when Jim Kerr came on a promo tour, he took the album nice and he took it over and read it and he goes, why are the songs out of order? And the guy, you know, happily explained, because I figured, you know, Canadian audiences, blah, 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 blah. And they had to hold Jim Kerr back, like, yeah. You know?
Yeah, I want to say stay in your lane, like stay in your lane.
You know, they think that because they have a big record collection, they have an artistic say to what you've been working on for the last 3 years. So, man.
All right. So, yeah. Any stories like that you want to draw up here? I'm just loving it. So,
I have another one. I've got good friends, Voivod, and this is one of my favorite stories that I tell all the time. Is that one of their records got held up, and so it was. Michelle, the drummer, away, sent us a picture that he wanted on the cover of a Martian, and we think that the Martian's ears are too big. And so they weren't putting out the record in the States because the Martian's ears were too big on the cover. And so luckily the president, apparently the story goes, the president just told the guy to leave the room and go pack his bags.
Okay.
That was it.
Love it. We just did, I guess about a week ago, we did a deep dive into the history of heavy metal in Canada. I had Martin Popoff on the show and we covered deep dives. So a lot of Voivod chatter in that one. We did sort of an Anvil versus Voivod. So if anyone listening wants some more of that, it was fantastic. And by the way, I'm wishing I had met you earlier. I did a deep dive of New Wave in Canada. You were represented, of course, but I had Rob Pruse.
Great guy, lovely guy.
And I always wonder, like Men Without Hats in Montreal, and then you had Spoons here in the GTA. And I always wondered, what was your relationship like with the guys, with the people from the Spoons?
Well, the Spoons, we've always been really friendly with them. We shared a lot of stages back in the '80s, and today, I mean, we still share a stage. We did shows with them not too long ago. Last year, we did shows with the Spoons, and also Gord plays with he plays guitar for Flock of Seagulls now. So I see him all over the place. We see each other like every couple of weeks. And but back then, what I wanted to say was, back then, being in a band was a lot different than being in a band now, for me anyway. Back then, it was a lot of competition. Mm. Being in a band was like being on a on a hockey team. You know, you're fighting for the top 40. There's only, you know, so many places in the top 10. There's only so many clubs to play in Toronto. There's only so many journalists and pages in a newspaper and, you know, that type of thing. So there was much more competition back then. We were all friendly, but it was there was a healthy competition. And now it's more the people that are out there, nobody's doing it to pay the rent. Everybody's out on the road now because they just loved being on the road. And there's no, everybody's happy to see each other when they're out there. And it's a great time.
Love it. Ken writes in, one of the loudest bands I've ever heard in a bar. He saw you at Wilders in North Bay. And he says, surprisingly loud, but well worth the damage to my hearing.
I think the loudest show I ever saw was The Jam. That was
a loud one.
A loud one, yeah. Pinned me up against the back wall.
Wow. All right, I'm going to play another Jam that we're going to 87 here, and we're quickly going to get you up to current day, of course. I have a new Jam loaded up too. But let's hear this song from 1987.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Pop Goes the World by Men Without Hats.
Pop Goes the World. I got questions about Pop Goes the World here. Let me pull them up here. So, I mean, their questions kept flying in. I had questions from Gene, who wanted to know how long did they walk around in circles?
Quite a while. They're still walking.
This one's about, I'm going back to the safety dance and then I'm going to bring you back to Pop Goes the World. But Rock Golf wants to know, do you get paid when Safety Dance appears on a compilation album?
Yeah, yeah. We get paid every time it appears anywhere.
And now back to Mark. So Mark, you basically said you don't have to get another job, and that was a hint there. But Mark has a guess, and I'm just going to read you what he says, and you can react to it or not. But his guess is that you've made $15 million off of Safety Dance. Is he out to lunch, or should we just tell him it's rude to talk about money?
Well, it's rude to talk about money, but,
Is he close?
Well, you know, I don't know the exact figure, but it's been played a lot. You know, it's one of the top songs of the 80s. It's been in pop culture and in all kinds of TV shows and all kinds of ads and movies and everything like that. So yeah, it adds up. I don't know the exact figure, but it adds up.
I like this question from George. Have you ever heard Sulu Dance, the parody that was played on Howard Stern quite a bit in the 1990s?
Yeah, I have. That was good.
Yeah, that was a fun one, Sulu Dance. And speaking of Pop Goes the World, so I looked it up. It went to number 2 in Canada, but it was in the top 20 on the Billboard Hot 100. Another big hit for you. Cam Gordon wants to know, whatever happened to the Duke of Earl?
Jeez. Good question.
Cam's always got the good questions. Sean writes in, we saw the popularity of Men Without Hats in Canada, but what was the popularity outside of Canada, and how did you and the band react And what is the acceptance like for you? So we did talk about how you, that was a bit, these are big hits globally, but what is it like when you tour outside of Canada? This is a Sean question here.
It's great. I mean, actually this time I put the band back on the road 10 years ago and we've been on the road. We've been touring around the world since then. And we've actually gotten to more places this time around than the first time. We've reached, you know, a lot more countries. We've been, you know, Australia, South Africa, you know, we've been to Scandinavia twice in the last 10 years. So these are places that we didn't hit the first time. We were sort of concentrating on North America the first time around. And so it's been really, it's been great going to other countries. I mean, these people have been waiting. They've waited 40 years for seeing to see the band. We're on a lot of people's bucket lists. So it's good to be able to fulfill their wishes.
And you seem, I mean, you're big in many countries, but you seem particularly big in South Africa, it seems. South Africa, big Men Without Hats fans.
Yeah, yeah. We just did it. We just headlined a huge festival there. Wow. And just outside of Johannesburg. And it was great. It was
good for you. Good for you, man. I love this. I love this success story. Now, Jerry the Garbage Man has so many questions about the Pop Goes the World video. And I'll just run down his questions. But was that a girl or a very small woman with the crimped hair? What's up with Elvis on guitar? And how did that baby play keyboard?
Yeah, you know, the baby, that's the magic of video. There's like all kinds of, they have all kinds of tricks up their sleeves, those guys. They can make us believe anything. The girl was, she was about 13 or 14, but she was a lot wiser than her years. And the Elvis is, we're big Elvis fans. I think we did that just to prove that Elvis wasn't that fat when he died.
Right. Now, Rich Thorpe says, the guitar player woman reminds me of Amy Mann from Till Tuesday. And then Rich Thorpe says, Elvis sort of looked like a George Michael from the Faith video. And he says, maybe the kid was a prodigy like Mozart. And the lead singer, this is, I guess, is kind of a cross between, I guess this is you, if you took Daryl Hall and Michael Hutchence and you slammed them together.
That's not bad.
No, I think that's good. Like,
I'll take it.
Take that. That's a compliment, my friend. And Rock Golf wants to know, did you have to get permission to use... Bonhomme, I believe. Bonhomme.
Bonhomme.
Yeah. See, I'm showing my English is showing here. But yeah, did you need permission to use Bonhomme?
We might have, but we might have needed permission, but we didn't ask for it. So we haven't gotten any feedback from the carnival yet.
Rock Golf also he was on the Wikipedia page for Pop Goes the World, and it says the actress who played Jenny is unknown. Can you fill in that blank? Because we have listeners who will go to Wikipedia and add in information they've learned from the Toronto Mic'd episode. So can you fill in that blank?
I unfortunately can't. I'd like to find out who she.
It will remain a mystery.
Track down a lot of the people, like the baby on the Pop Goes the World cover. That one will remain a mystery. We've found everybody else, but not her.
Michael Moniz, I like this note because he's asking about an album I think criminally underrated as well, but he says the Sideways album and the song Sideways, he says it's a criminally underrated grungy song and album. He loves the rock side of your songwriting and... what else he says? There's a Blow at High Dough cover from the Covers EP that he loves. So, like, can we just speak to the fact that the sound of Men Without Hats, it gets sort of harder as we enter the 90s. It gets sort of more of an edge to it.
Yeah, well, that was just the product of me hanging out with a bunch of local Montreal musicians, hanging out with Away, the drummer from Voivod, and John Kasner from the Doughboys.
Love him.
And a couple other people, and we would, when the bars closed, we'd end up in a jam space, you know, just jamming. And I just started writing songs for these jams, and it turned into an album. It's just one of those organic things. This was Sideways was a great project. We had nothing but fun making it. We toured Canada. We took it across Canada and had a blast everywhere we went. And it was just one of those albums that everything came together and we just had a lot of fun doing it.
And shout out to the Doughboys. I don't even want to reveal this, but I do have a Doughboys song I'm going to play during the next toast. And I know, Ivan, you don't know what I'm talking about, but the next toast episode is the 17th of March. That's St. Patrick's Day. And I have a Doughboys song lined up. So just shouting that out here. But Paul Hunter has a great question for you here. He says, he goes, if you run out of questions for Ivan, and I doubt you will, ask him if he knows whatever happened to Peter Seabrook. He was the guitarist for Men Without Hats in the early days when they were more of a punk band. I worked with Seabrook at a summer job back in my student days. Seemed like a cool dude. I realize that's too specific a question for a general audience, but it would be interesting to hear why they changed their sound and what it did for the dynamics of the band. And he puts in parentheses, as I recall, Peter left on his own. What say you, Ivan?
Oh yeah, Peter. First of all, he was the drummer. He wasn't the Wikipedia says he's the guitar player, but he was actually the drummer.
We'll fix that.
John Gurin, Dave Hill was the bass player. John Gurin was the guitarist, and Pete Seabrook was the drummer. And I kind of lost touch with Pete after that. The other two I kept in touch with, Dave and John, I kept in touch with until now. I'm still in touch with them. But Pete, I lost touch with, so.
Okay. So there you go, Paul. Thanks for that question. Nothing's too specific for this podcast. That's what we love, getting in the weeds. But, all right. So, Ivan, I know your Men Without Hats is back, and we're going to talk about that in just a moment. But can we talk just briefly about the solo, Ivan, if you will? And I'm going to just play a little song here, which we in the FOTM community, we consider it kind of Chris Shepherd-esque. Okay.
Well,
by the way, do you know
where
is Chris Shepherd? Do you have any idea? I was on a Zoom with, like, I don't know, 13 or 14 people who used to work at, one still does, but used to work at CFNY. And this is a special episode 1000. And funny thing, Freddie P. from Humble and Fred was just calling me right there. I just turned off my ringer. But all this is to say, nobody knows where Chris Shepherd is. So let me play the song and then we'll talk about Super Bad Girls. And then we'll see if you know where Chris Shepherd is. Here's Super Bad Girls.
I'll tell you who I hate the most. Tell me to my face, and I will go in outer space. I tell you, I believe in almost anything. Just give me
bad girls, super bad girls. I love a bad girl. The ones that run around and sleep together. Bad girls, super bad girls. I love a bad girl. The ones that put the trouble really do it to me. Face it, even got an outer space suit. You know, I believe in almost anything. Just give me
bad girls, a super bad girls. I love a bad girl. The ones that run around and sleep together. Bad girls, a super bad girls. Love a bad girl. The ones that look for trouble really do it. Bad girls.
Kudos to you, Ivan. You're always, you're not afraid to change up your sound and try something different, man. That sounds great. What can you tell me about this Chris Shepherd-esque period of your career here? Here, I'll turn this down because Ivan's having some technical difficulties, and as soon as we get him to rejoin, so let's listen to this jam while I try to reconnect. Oh, here he comes back into the Zoom. Okay, Bad internet when wherever Ivan is zooming in from. And I apologize, but you know, that's part of the adventure here. You never know what's going to happen with a remote conversation. I'm just glad we have Ivan from Men Without Hats on the program, and we're going to put up with some technical difficulties if that's what it takes to capture these stories. While we wait to see if Ivan can reconnect with us, I see on my status here that he's joining, but he is having some internet problems. I want to thank some sponsors of the program. Great Lakes Brewery, fresh craft beer brewed right here in southern Etobicoke. Get it at LCBO's. Palma Pasta, authentic Italian food. Go to palmapasta.com. They're in Mississauga and Oakville. StickerU.com. They've just been tremendous supporters. And if you need stickers, decals, whatnot, you go to StickerU.com. Canna Cabana, that's where we get our cannabis and cannabis accessories. They won't be beat on price. What a fantastic retail store across this country, over 100 locations. Thank you, Canna Cabana. And of course, Ridley Funeral Home. Shout out to Ridley Funeral Home. Brad's got a new podcast and you should check that out. Ryobi. Ryobi, of course, is the newest sponsor of Toronto Mic'd, and it's fantastic having them on board. And what my wife absolutely loves about Ryobi, and she knows her her tools, she loves the 18-volt, 1-plus high-capacity battery because it's better runtime, four times more runtime, four times longer-lasting charge, 20% lighter. The fuel gauge lets you know the battery status before the work begins. And best of all, it works with all Ryobi 18-volt, 1-plus tools and chargers. What a fantastic system. Ryobi, thank you for your support.
Hello.
Okay, welcome back, Ivan. I was asking about that period of time when you were what I called Chris Shepherd-esque, and I was giving you kudos because you're not afraid to change up your sound. You're constantly evolving, and I thought it sounded great.
Yeah, that was a project I just decided to do. I wanted to work with John Punter, a producer who produced a lot of my favorite bands like Roxy Music and a lot of 70s and 80s stuff. So I went into studio with him and put this all together. It was mid 90s. So there was kind of a rave scene happening.
Right.
And the whole Chris Shepherd connection was quite spot on because we were in contact a lot in those days. We bumped into each other a lot. He had a dance project at that time going on that was really happening.
Yeah, was that BTS? Cool. What was that? BTK? BT something, I wonder. Or was it Lips? He had a bunch of projects going on. When was the last time you talked to Chris?
It was at a Canadian Music Week thing a few years ago. It was quite a few years ago, like over 5 years ago, but I saw him there.
All right, if you hear from him, let me know. I'm trying to track the man down. I have questions for him as well. Now, you do revive Men Without Hats in 2003. There's a comeback album, No Hats Beyond This Point, and you kind of hit the road again. So basically, let me know what you know caused you to get the band back together. And then I have a couple more questions, and then I want to play some new stuff.
Yeah, about 10 years ago, I got a call from an agent in the States who was putting together 80s packages and just starting. It was just, you know, there was starting to be an interest in 80s bands. The demographic was kind of right there. And so he called me and said, would I like to put the band back together, go on the road? I said, sure. And the first tour he got us was opening up for the Human League and the B-52s.
Wow.
All across. It was just like, you know, you haven't I hadn't done a show in over 25 years, and just to, for the first tour to be opening up for those guys was kind of a mind blower. So we had a great time, and we've been doing that for the last 10 years. Like I say, going to places that we didn't get to go the first, been fun. It's been great just seeing our fans. The thing now is we see our fans, we see them with their kids and with their grandkids even sometimes now. Right. So it's cool.
But this begs a question, and then this goes back to the underappreciated Sideways album. You break up the band in 93. Of course, it gets back together 10 years later. But is it because of the negative reception of Sideways? Because, I mean, a lot of people wrote in with love for Sideways. In fact, DJ Dream Doctor said, I'd like to ask him about the lost album Sideways, because he can't find it anywhere. Like, so help DJ Dream Doctor, where would he find Sideways? And is it basically the negative reception to Sideways that causes the 10-year hiatus for Men Without Hats?
No, I don't think so. It was, we had a great time. Like I say again, we had a great time making Sideways. We knew it wasn't going anywhere. We knew that the record company had no idea what was going on. The only reason they let us make it was because I was contractually obligated to make another record with them.
Right.
And I made them a deal. I said, hey, give me half of what give me half the advance that it says on the contract. And they went for it. Anytime a record company can save money, they go for it. And then they ended up with this record with no keyboards. And they went, no keyboards. And they didn't know what to do with it. So it stopped there. But we had... Like I say, we had a blast making it. So that's the main point.
So you just wanted to do other things, maybe? Just take a break from the band for a decade?
I took a break. I was a stay-at-home dad for 10 years. I had a son and raised him while his mother was getting her degree. And that was a unique experience too. That was just one of the lucky things that happened to me during my life was
well,
being able
great.
To do that.
You never get that back. I mean, you only have that one chance to be there at that point in your son's life, and it's awesome you could be there for that time.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. We have a bond now that's like, we're like brothers almost. It's really funny. I'm like his older brother. It's great.
Amazing. Topper says, how did the Faith No More cover project come to be? It's fucking awesome. Would love to hear how it happened. Ivan kills it. A Faith No More cover project? Tell me about this.
Yeah, that was Jason Rockman. He's the lead singer of the Montreal band Slaves on Dope.
Okay, yeah.
And... he works for, he's the main DJ at Shome now in Montreal, at Shome FM.
Right.
And he and I have always been really close. He was, I met him through John Kasner. He was a good friend of John Kasner's. And I met him through John. And Jason has been our number one guy in Montreal, you know, for the last 10 years. He's been... a part-time job for him promoting Men Without Hats. Great. But anyway, he put this together. He knows all the guys. He's on a totally personal level with everybody in that video. And he asked me and I jumped at it. I said, for sure. That was an awesome experience.
Amazing. And where does DJ Dream Doctor find Sideways? Like, how can an album be lost? Oh. You can't stream that? What's going on?
I don't know. I just, that's kind of out of my hands. I would say Amazon. I'm not Amazon, but eBay maybe, or something like that, or just get a YouTube to MP3 converter. And
right.
Go that way.
there's always a way. All right. Tell me about, okay. So I want to hear about the new album here. So I have a song. In fact, maybe I'll play the song. And I mean, I should set this up by saying, Again, Part 1 came out in 2021, and then Again, Part 2 is literally coming out, I believe, tomorrow, which
That's
is,
it, yeah.
And it's your first album of original songs in 10 years. Can that be true?
Yep, that's it.
Okay, let's hear a bit of this, and then I need more details on this. So let's listen to, what do I got loaded up here? Let's play it and find out, actually. Let's get surprised together.
The world. should end today. If the world should end right now, it wouldn't matter anyway. It wouldn't matter anyhow. If the world should end today, if the world should end right here, disappear, and there's nothing I could say, 'cause you took my breath away. When I first laid eyes on you, my world ended. When I first laid eyes on you, time suspended. When I first laid eyes on you, finally I knew why one and one is two.
If the world should end today, Ivan, you still got those pipes, buddy.
Thank you.
It sounds great. It doesn't even sound like it sounds. It sounds like Men Without Hats, and you sound great. And I can't believe this is the first album of new stuff in a decade.
Yeah. It goes by fast.
So, what can you tell me about the again? This is called Again. It's called Again, Part Two, and it's literally out tomorrow. But what can you share with me about what we can expect from this new record?
Well, the songwriting spans about 40 years. This is an album. Like usually, I'm a watershedder. Usually, I don't do anything for 2 years, and then I spend a week or two writing 25 songs. And this album was a bit different. This album was going back into the vault and getting songs that never made it past the demo stage of the Safety Dance era and Pop Goes the World era. And then there was a whole bunch of songs that I wrote in the back of the tour bus while we've been on tour for the last 10 years. And then there were a couple of songs that we wrote in the studio while we were putting this whole thing together. But the main story about this record is that it started off as a piano vocal album. It started off as a solo project. I was going to do another solo record and sort of reimagine some songs of my catalog and some cover songs that had been important to me growing up. And it's when we did the Tragically Hip song, I recorded that one piano and voice. And after I recorded it, we listened to it and I said, you know, I'd like to hear this one done up by, you know, the full Men Without Hats treatment, just out of curiosity. And once we did that, we put the whole band behind it, and I really liked it. I thought that was a good direction to go in, and that kind of changed the direction of the album, and it became a full Men Without Hats album. And we made it a double album. It was a double album with, you know, still the reimagining of the Safety Dance song with the No Friends of Mine and covers, and then songs that we, you know, that, like I say, we picked out of everywhere.
Amazing. I mean, that song we just listened to, If the World Should End Today, it seems to be, is that like an ecology song? Is this about the our Mother Earth?
No, but you could, it's one of those, you know, that's what I like to do with my lyrics, is to make the interpretation open to everybody. And this one's about seeing the most beautiful girl in the world, most beautiful woman in the world for the first time.
Wow.
And but I can, you know, like I say, you can interpret it
sure
a lot of different ways. I see it sometimes as seeing my son for the first time coming out of his mother's body. I still remember that moment, you know, when he just twisted his head around and looked at me, you know, and he was half in, half out. And it was kind of, that's one of those moments, boy, I tell you.
That's, you know, those moments. I have four of those moments where you see your child like emerge, and that split second where you know it is like that's the moment you never forget that moment, and it's just it's surreal, really. It's just like you're witnessing a miracle, and this person will be like you mentioned. You're like an almost like an older brother now. You're so close with your son, but like this person that you're now laying eyes on for the first time will be like closer than close. Like you can't even use the English language to maybe French has better words for this, but how close you'll be of that human being you're laying eyes on for the first time. And that's just, it's just beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's, I was great. I was great. I was lucky. I had a son late in life. I was 45 when I had my son but I'm glad I did.
I'm glad you did too. And I'm glad that we got your internet figured out. I was thinking, oh man, like what an opportunity. And now technology is going to mess it up. But, you know, it was great having these conversations and even playing some older Men Without Hats songs, some solo stuff. And then hearing the new jam, which sounds fantastic. So good luck with the new album and let people know, like, where would you like people to, grab a copy or to I guess do you grab copies I guess some of your demos still grabbing copies, but where would you like people to hear again part two?
There's it's everywhere. I mean, it's all over the streaming platforms. It's
what a dumb question.
So it's on our website safetydance.com. You can buy physical copies along with Men Without Hats Boots.
Then it's that's ironic, right? You can't, you know, because you can't be a man without a hat if you're wearing the hat.
Yeah, well, you gotta sort of see both sides of it. You know?
And that brings us to the end of our 1012th show. You can follow me on Twitter. I'm at Toronto Mike. Men Without Hats are at Men Without Hats 1. That's numeric 1. Our friends at Great Lakes Brewery, they're at Great Lakes Beer. Palma Pasta is at Palma Pasta. Sticker U is at Sticker U. Ridley Funeral Home is at Ridley FH. Canna Cabana are at Canna Cabana _. And Ryobi are at Ryobi Tools USA. See you all next week. I wonder who